Alright, so today I've received the second component of my upcoming Threadripper build, the motherboard. And if you are going to release a motherboard called Extreme to service such an extravagant processor as a Threadripper 1950X, you better know what you're doing. And today I have received the beyond extravagant ROG Zenith Extreme Edition from Asus. Look at this. I'm not sure that I'll be able to talk about all the different aspects of this motherboard because there are a lot of them. But at least we are going to filter the most important ones, the one who really make this board worthy of the name Extreme. But I promise you, it does. So without any further ado, roll that intro. The Zenith Extreme is the very first of its kind. It aims at paralleling what Asus had done for the Kaby Lake or the Skylake processors, releasing the gamers friendly Maximus lineup of motherboards. And so normally we should be seeing more of those. Now, the thing which really makes this board special, or one of the things which makes this board special, is the fact that it supports, of course, only the AMD Threadripper processor, which I made a complete review a few weeks ago and that you should really check out. But it also is an extreme edition, and that is what I find surprising in this review. Usually manufacturers, when they release a new lineup of motherboard, starts with an entry level. For example, Maximus has the Hero, then the Formula, the Code, the Apex, and finally the Extreme Edition. And here, right away, on the very first release, Asus send us to the other end of the spectrum with an Extreme Edition. That opens the question, will there be another Zenith at any point in time? I don't know. But what I do know, it does cost $540 US. But once you take a closer look at this, you start to realize that this is made for a monstrous build, for something really special and expensive and in your face. But nothing will illustrate better my point than the unboxing. Alright, let's take a closer look to this massive box. First we have our motherboard. I'm going to take it away for now, we don't need it, as well as the stickers. And we are going to take a closer look to the accessories. First comes the USB dongle with all the motherboard drivers, that's pretty neat. Then comes all the coupons, quick start guide, under cup, and the manual. Okay, so this is special. This is a 10 gigabit LAN PCIe Express adapter. That's one of the star accessories who comes with the motherboard, and we'll review this later, but it's very special. Here we have our DIMM.2 adapter, which can accommodate up to two M.2 solid state drive, our four-way SLI bridge, a three-way SLI bridge, and finally our two-way SLI bridge. So yes, it does cover the full spectrum of multi-GPUs. Here we have our fan extension card, our two Wi-Fi and Wi-Gi antennas. This is a supporting stand for our multiple GPU configuration, three pairs of SATA cables, an RGB cable extension, our RGB addressable cable extension, some M.2 solid state drive screw and screw razor, our Q-bridge for our front panel, a 3-in-1 thermistor cable. This is our DIMM.2 fan stand packs, a solid rock sticker, a wafer cable, more M.2 solid state drive screw and screw razor, some mounting screws for our fan extension, and finally another quick start guide for our 10 GB LAN. Alright, so let's move to the motherboard itself. Start with the obvious. This is an EATX motherboard, meaning that it's about 30.5 by 27.7 centimeters. And that means that you better get yourself the right casing. So get something big, because this is big. On the other side, you'll see that there is a back shield. And the back shield looks pretty cool. There's a ROG logo right on it. The reason why we have it here is first because I suspect there's a couple of thermopads which help with heat dissipation on the soldering points of certain components. And the second reason is because we have a very nice looking RGB LED addressable cable sandwiched between it and the motherboard. Back on top of the motherboard, the first thing we can see is this massive 4094 pins LGA socket, the so-called TR4S, which obviously can only support the AMD Threadripper processor. Around it, we have a quad-channel configuration, so we can put up to 128GB of DDR4 RAM, overclockable up to 2.8GHz. That's pretty nice. And right under it, we have an DIMM.2 socket, and that will allow us to put up to two M.2 solid-state drive in a, well, a vertical slash horizontal position, and they can both transfer data up to 4 third generation bus speed. Pretty intense.
And in an horizontal position, we have a third M.2 solid state drive right under the chipset heat shield. Now, something I really appreciate about those heat shields is that they do have a thermopad on their other side, and that will be particularly useful to avoid early thermothrottling coming from our solid state drive. They do tend to heat very quickly as we request of them more intensive tasks. PCIe wise, this board features 6 different slots. A single slot single speed, a 4 slot 4 speed, and 4 16 slots which do feature different kind of speeds.
It means we can put 4 video cards on this thing. This is a quad GPU configurable motherboard, and that's really cool. But I really don't know what it is for. There are no video games which can handle 4 GPUs, and SLI and the new MGPU replacing the Crossfire from AMD seems to be dropping anything with triple or quadruple GPU configuration. So I think that, you know, we up to 3, we're pretty solid. I can see a use. Some games are optimized for it. 4, maybe for mining. I'm not sure. If you're gonna go for one GPU configuration, you're gonna use this PCI slot. If you're gonna go for a 2 SLI configuration, you're gonna go for those 2 ones. If you are going to go for a 3-way GPU configuration, you wanna make sure to use those 3 16 slot PCI. They will be all running at 16 bus speed. And if you are going to go for a 4-way GPU configuration, then those 2 16 PCI slots will be sharing their bandwidth. Therefore, you'll have an 8 and 8 bus speed for those 2 ones.
All right, that's going at a good speed, don't you think? Let's turn our motherboard around. This is our I/O back panel, and the first thing I want to notice is the fact that the I/O shield is built in the motherboard, and I love this. I've seen that on the Maximus 9 Formula, I've seen it on the X299 Strix, and I think that's, it's a simple thing which just makes our lives so much easier and saves us 3 good minutes on our build, and really no added value in installing an I/O shield in a case. So kudos to Asus for that, or kudos, whatever you call that.
Starting from the left, we have our BIOS button as well as our clear CMOS button. Right after that, we have our Wi-Fi adapter. The two golden antennas outputs are for our normal Wi-Fi, the 802.11ad Wi-Fi, which usually transmits about a gigabit per second and up to 300 feet. The darker antenna output is for our YGig antenna. Alright, so let me explain this one. YGig is a new Wi-Fi standard. It can transmit on the 60 GHz band, which is rarely used. So that means higher bandwidth transfer, so theoretically up to 7 gigabit per second. But on the other hand, it has to be on a very close range, and it really doesn't like walls either. This is more for virtual gaming or a very high speed transfer between a computer to another in close proximity. Right next to it, we have 8 3.1 first generation USB plugs, which yields data transfer up to 5 gigabit per second. Our gigabit LAN, not that it is red because it is surge protected. 2 second generation 3.1 USB plug, type A and type C, which yields data transfer up to 10 gigabit per second. And finally, our 6 audio channel, 5 analog and 1 optical. Note the absence of any ring colors on our analog input, and that's because there are some little LEDs inside the plug. So as soon as you're gonna lit up your system, you should be able to see the relevant colors through the LED lighting.
On the front side of our motherboard, we have, well, first, a very good looking RGB LED addressable cable I was talking about, and it looks awesome once it's turned on. I'll show you that later again. But other than that, we have 6 3.0 SATA plugs, which can all transfer data up to 6 gigabit per second, a U.2
U.2. U.2 connector, which is for proprietary solid-state drive, hard drives, and they can transfer data up to 10 gigabit per second. Okay, peripherals. Peripherals on the motherboard. So very quickly, we have one USB 2.0 connector right here for our front panel, two USB 3.1 first generation connector for our front panel as well here, audio front panel connectors here, and what else do we have for the front panel? Yes, we have a second generation 3.1 connector right here, which can transfer data up to 10 gigabit per second.
All right, so far we've reviewed the general aspect of our motherboard, but here comes my favorite part of the video, the enthusiastic part. The very first thing we're going to talk about is a QLED screen. Usually on enthusiast-friendly motherboard, we have a couple of small QLED digital screens, which gives us all the QLED errors and sometimes even the current temperature of the CPU. But in our case, we have something much more exciting. We have an OLED screen, which is housed right on the I/O panel. And that doesn't only give us the usual error codes, which helps us troubleshooting the system, but it also gives us the current frequency, the current clock of our CPU, which, if you are into overclocking your CPU, will be a very useful item to play with. We also have a couple of buttons directly soldered onto our motherboard, the start and reset button. It will make your life easier in the case you want to troubleshoot or even make a first test of your build without going through the front panel connectors. Extreme Motherboard Edition is known for giving a lot more of options and accessories for custom water cooling systems. So first we have a water block all-in-one connector right here, and this will give us access to a flurry of detectors and sensors options such as water flow, temperature, and in and out leaking sensors. So that is very useful in the case you're going to go for a more complex custom water cooling system. In addition, we also have a separated water flow detector, a PWM water pump connector, water flow in and out sensors, and a couple of external temperature sensor connectors. So this board can handle whatever custom water cooling system you can throw at it. And finally, here comes the RGB effect. Well, the very first thing we need to talk about is the Aura Sync effect, which Asus equipped all its component and motherboard with. The Aura Sync effect will sync all the different RGBs on the components in your build to glow in an organized way or in an harmonious way. So it looks really, really cool. So if you do care about what your build looks like as much as what it can do, this is something you really want to pay attention to. And this board is absolutely unique in what it can do. First, we have this very nice RGB addressable cable, which is sandwiched between the backplate and the motherboard. We have an RGB strip as well as an OLED screen hidden right under our chipset heat shield. And finally, an infinity OLED screen on our I/O panel, which can loop up to 16 million saturated colors. In conclusion, well, it's an expensive board for an expensive build. I mean, it's $540, but you do get what you're paying for. We're paying this to get innovation and accommodate an already extravagant processor, the AMD Threadripper. And we have the DIMM.2 for some extra M.2 solid state drive. We have this crazy Y-gig adapter, which I've never seen before, I never heard before, which apparently is going to be transferring data up to 7 gigabit per second wirelessly. We have this crazy quad GPU configuration, which, you know, I'm not sure any game is optimized for that much, and even drivers, so let's see where that's going to take us. But here's the thing, if this is your first build, if you're contemplating to buy a motherboard for your very first build, don't take the extreme one. Don't take an extreme edition. I'd rather see you spending less money and get what you really need, and you know, such as the Prime X399A, than spend $540 on something you are not going to utilize. But if you are like me and are in the business of building stuff like this, then I would not go with anything else than the Zenith Extreme. Not if you have an AMD Threadripper CPU to work with. Just saying.